ist der goldene Pave geflogen, geflogen. Und die Nacht hat geöffnet die goldene Augen. Lichtiger meiner Schlafwein.
Autumn. You know that moment when summer, so recently buoyant and vigorous, universal summer, hugging to itself all things imaginable, people, events, objects, one day sustains a barely perceptible injury. The sun still blazes, dense and copious. The landscape still wields the classic magisterial flourish bequeathed to this season by the genius of Poussin. But strange to report, we return from a morning stroll, oddly wearied and jejune. Was there something to be ashamed of? We feel a bit out of sorts, avoid looking at each other. Why? And we know that at dusk, someone or other will take himself with a worried smile to a remote corner of summer and knock, knock at the wall to check if, in fact, the sound is still full and genuine. This testing carries with it a perverse relish in treacherous unmasking, a small frisson of scandal. But officially, we are still full of respect and loyalty. We are dealing with a solid firm, an enterprise with sound financial backing. And yet, if the next day brings tidings of summer's bankruptcy, it seems like the day before yesterday's news, and no longer has the explosive impact of a scandal. And as the auction of assets takes its sober and revitalizing course, and the desecrated apartments, stripped and empty, fill with luminous, sober echoes, this rouses no regret or sentiment. All this liquidating of summer displays the same languor, irrelevance, casual spirit of a belated carnival that has run on into Ash Wednesday. On the other hand, indulging in pessimism is perhaps premature. Negotiations are still going on, the summer's reserves not yet exhausted, full rehabilitation is yet on the cards. But deliberation and cool heads are not what summer people are known for. Even the hotel keepers who have invested over their heads in the stock market of summer are capitulating. Really, such lack of loyalty and proper feeling towards a faithful ally shows little trace of the royal merchant. They are shopkeepers, petty, craven souls, incapable of taking the long view. One and all, they hug to their bellies what they've scraped together. Cynically, they take off the mask of courtesy and the cutaway suit to reveal the cashier. And we too pack our luggage. I am 15 years old and quite unburdened by mundane duties. Since an hour remains before our departure, I run outdoors once more to say goodbye to the summer place, check out the season's yield, decide what may be taken along and what will have to be relinquished for good in these doomed surroundings. But at the little round plaza in the park, empty now and bright in the afternoon sun, next to the Mickiewicz monument, the truth about the crisis of summer dawns in my soul. In the euphoria of this revelation, I climb up the two steps of the pedestal and, drawing an impassioned arc with my eyes and outspread arms as if addressing the entire resort, I say, "Farewell, season. You were very beautiful and rich. No other summer can compare with you. Today I recognize this, even though there have been times when you made me terribly unhappy and sad. As something to remember me by, I leave you my adventures, littered all over the park and the lanes and gardens. I can't take my age 15 back with me. That will have to stay behind here for good. I've slipped a drawing I did for you into a crack between two beams on the porch of the bungalow where I stayed, as another souvenir. Now you're sinking among the shades, and down to the underworld along with you goes all this town full of cottages and gardens, too. You have no offspring. You and this town are dying, the last of your kind. But you're not guiltless, O season. Let me tell you wherein your guilt lies. You did not want to stay, O season, within the bounds of the given. No reality satisfied you. You broke out beyond the realm of what can be realized. Finding no surcease in reality, you created a superstructure out of the figurative stuff of metaphor. You moved among associations and illusions, the imponderables between things. All things referred to other things, which in turn called further things to witness, and so on, ad infinitum. In the end, your honeyed words grew cloying. People wearied of rocking on the billows of an unending rhetoric. Yes, rhetoric, pardon the expression. This became clear when, in many imaginations in one place and another, a longing for the genuine and essential welled up. That moment already spelled your defeat. The borders of your universality became visible. Your grand style, your splendid baroque, which satisfied the needs of reality when you were in your prime, now turned out to be a mannered trick. Your dulcitudes and reveries bore the stamp of childish inflation. Your nights were vast and boundless, like the megalomaniac aspirations of lovers, or they were swirling spectacles like the hallucinations of feverish patients. Your perfumes were extravagant, beyond the ability of human delight to absorb them. Under the magic of your touch, everything dematerialized, grew towards ever further, higher forms. Eating your apples, one dreamed of fruit from the territory of paradise. Your peaches brought up the image of ethereal fruit that is consumed by smell alone. Your palate held only the highest registers of colour. You didn't know the saturation and pith of the dark, earthy, greasy browns. Autumn is the human soul's yearning for matter, essence, boundary. When for unexplored reasons human metaphors, projects, dreams begin to hanker for realization, and the time of autumn is at hand. Those phantoms that formerly spread out over the furthest reaches of the human cosmos, lent its high vaults the colours of their spectra, now return to man, seeking the warmth of his breath, the cosy, narrow shelter of his home, the niche that holds his bed. Man's house becomes like the little stable of Bethlehem, the core around which all demons, all spirits of the upper and lower spheres condense. The time of beautiful, classical gestures, Latinate rhetoric, the histrionic roundedness of the South is over. Autumn looks for herself in the sap and primitive vigour of the Dürers and Bruegels. That form bursts from the overflow of material, hardens into whirls and knots, seizes matter in its jaws and talons, squeezes, ravishes, deforms, and dismisses it from its clutches, imprinted with the marks of this struggle as half-formed hunks, with the brand of uncanny life stamped in the grimaces extruded from their wooden faces. All this and more, I said to the empty half-circle of the park, which seemed to recede before me. only some fragments of this soliloquy issued from my mouth, partly because I couldn't find the proper words, partly because I was only miming my oration, eking out words with gesticulation. I made reference to nuts, the classic fruits of autumn, kindred to house furnishings, nourishing, tasty, and durable. I mentioned chestnuts, those polished models of fruit, cup and ball toys made for children to play with. I spoke of autumn apples on windowsills, flushed and honest, homey, prosaic red. Dusk was fumigating the air by the time I returned to the boarding house. Two large carriages were already drawn up in the courtyard against our leave-taking. The horses, not yet harnessed, snorted with their heads buried in feed bags. The doors all stood wide open, the candles burning on the table in our room flickered in the draught. The fast descending gloom, the people grown faceless in the dusk who were hurrying out with luggage, the disorder in the ravished opened room, all this held a dismal suggestion of haste and belated panic, intimations of terror and disaster. Finally, we took our places in the deep caverns of the carriages and started off. The dark, dense, deep air of the fields blew over us. The coachmen drew vigorous cracks from this intoxicating ether with their long whips and took pains to steady the gates of the horses, whose powerful, splendidly sculptured withers rocked in the darkness between bushy slaps of their tails. Thus the two masses of horse flesh, rattling trunks and creaking leather shells, shifted through the dark, starless, solitary landscape of night. At times they seemed to disintegrate, come apart like crabs separating and scuttling away. Then the coachman would take the reins more firmly in hand, reassemble the scattered hoofbeats and gather them into regular, disciplined patterns. The lighted carriage lanterns sent long shafts into the deep of the night that telescoped out, broke off, and fled in great leaps into wild, vague voids. They slunk off on their long legs just to be able to mock the coachman with derisive gestures far off somewhere at the edge of the woods. Unperturbed, the coachman swept them with broadsides of whip cracking. The town lay sleeping when we drove in among its houses. Streetlights shone here and there in empty streets, as if created simply for the purpose of illuminating a low-slung house or balcony, or to rivet to one's memory a number over a closed gate. Caught by surprise at this late hour, heavy-lidded, padlocked shops, gates with prolapsed sills, signs jerked by the night wind, displayed the hopeless desolation, the profound orphanhood of objects left to themselves, objects forgotten by people. My sister's carriage turned into a side street while we drove on to the marketplace. The horses changed their gait when we entered the deep shade of the square. On the threshold of his open hallway, the barefoot baker stabbed us with a glance of dark eyes. The apothecary widow, still wide awake, proffered and withdrew raspberry balsam from a great jar. The pavement thickened under the horse's feet. Single and paired clinks of iron separated out of the clatter of hoofbeats more and more slowly and distinctly, and the scored facade of our house gradually drew out of the darkness and stopped beside the carriage. A maid opened the gate for us, a kerosene lamp with a reflector in her hand. Our enormous shadows grew up over the stairs and skewed off at the arches of the stairway. The flat was lit by a single candle which dipped its flame to the draught from the open window. The dark wallpaper was mildewed with the sorrows and afflictions of many ailing generations. Roused from its slumber and released from long solitude, the old furniture seemed to gaze at the returning family with wry knowingness and patient wisdom. "You can't escape from us," they seemed to be saying. "In the end, you have to re-enter the realm of our magic, because we've long since divided up among ourselves all your movements and gestures, risings up and settlings down, all your future days and nights. We can wait. We know." The vast cavernous beds, piled high with chilly layers of sheets and blankets, waited for our bodies. The night's floodgates groaned under the rising pressure of dark masses of slumber, a dense lava that was just about to erupt and pour over its dams, over the doors, the old wardrobes, the stoves where the wind sighed.
Wenn ich auf Fiedel geworden, du oder Beugen, und das Glück über uns hat verliebt, es ihr gebeugen. Zärtlicher Meiner,